morning, and welcome to worship this morning. We thank the band for that first introductory tune they played. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me, not for the years of time alone, but for eternity. And so this morning we're going to be looking at Isaiah chapter 6, and we'll have the reading a little bit later on. But to commence our worship this morning, we're going to join in, hopefully, maybe not in singing, maybe singing through our hearts, that wonderful song, number 31 in our song books, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning, our songs shall rise to thee, Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Just now we're going to see what Songs to Leader has to say about our Songs to Peace this week.
Thank you.
apologize. There is a little bit of a technical hitch there. This is when you wish Colin is here. And we think of Colin this morning. He's isolated at the moment, and we just pray for him in these days. I'll read the words out from the songbook. This is when you have good eyesight.
We all wanted to have a few days off over Christmas, but instead have been asked to come back to work.
This time it's a wave. This time we've seen a massive increase.
If we continue with the current rate of admissions, we are very, very close to becoming overwhelmed. So it is affecting anyone and everyone.
People are just beginning to be exhausted. It's been such a long year.
Somebody prayed for me. In those times when you feel you can't do it yourself, somebody prayed for me. Wonderful girls. And Colonel is going to come and lead us in the time of prayer.
There, where two or three are gathered together in your name, you are there in the midst of us. So we want to thank you for that as we come to praise you, to worship you, to give our thanks for all that you do for each one of us. As we have heard that beautiful song, Somebody Prayed for You, we thank you for each other, that we have been able to pray for each other during these difficult days. It hasn't been easy for many people, and we just want to give you thanks. We want to thank you especially for our National Health Service, for the people who have taken care of those who have been very ill. We thank you for our care workers in the old people's homes. And we thank you for each other here, as we have been sensitive to the needs of people in our core, in our core family. We give you thanks. We give you thanks especially as Colin is with us this morning. We thank you for prayer, as the prayers are being gone up to you for healing. And we just pray that you will continue the healing in Colin's life and all those who are suffering amongst our core family. As we pray for each other, we reach out to many places that are finding things hard. We pray especially for India, where so many people are dying. Give you thanks for the Salvation Army working there, how the hospitals have helped in so many areas. Not only India, but Africa and so many countries around the world. And we just pray that each will be given that courage and that strength that is needed. But most of all this morning, we thank you for your love, for your courage to give us, that you give us day by day. And we just pray that each day we may know fully your presence in our lives, to give us that encouragement to move on as things begin to relax a little in this country. Help us to be sensitive again to everyone who needs our prayers, and we continue praying in your name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for sharing prayer with us this morning. I don't know about you, but it was good last week, I thought, to have a couple of testimonies and for people to be able to share. And we're going to have that opportunity again this morning, singing a song, well, listening to the piano as Major Morris plays number 466 in our songbooks. And there'll be opportunity for you. Two people, okay? Don't all run at once. Yeah? Two people to come and share with us of the love of God. So we're going to listen And look at the words. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner. Do you call yourself a sinner? Only you yourself can, because I know me, as Major David's often said, I know me better than anybody else. A sinner, condemned, unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. And so we'll have the first verse, chorus, and then somebody be ready to share with us this morning.
Chris and I are not kind of, all right, we watch football, but we're not real football fans and what have you. But we thought, oh, we'll watch the football. But the thing was, we were finishing washing up from tea time in the kitchen and we missed the first goal. Anyhow, we went and sat down and we watched the rest, and then it was half time and we decided to go around garden and have a little look round. We missed the second goal, but I saw the third and the fourth. So I missed two of the things of excitement. But the marvellous thing is, with the Lord, we don't miss out on the blessings, do we? Even though we're not always in church now, we're not always in the meetings, the way the Lord ministers to us. I think Barbara said, you know, how we've kept contact with each other. Maureen has been sending us the messages with the songsters. And I think it's marvellous that I might miss out on some of the things which other people think are important. But I haven't missed out on God's love. I've missed the fellowship. But God has continued to bless. He's just reading his word, sometimes just listening to the CDs, and of course the meetings. Times we've sat on our settee listening to the meetings, and the Lord has come in a wonderful way. And I just say thank you.
Amen. We thank God, isn't it, that we can share in those blessings as well, can't we? And thank God England won. I'm sure most people will be happy about that. I'm not a big football fan. I don't watch it, so Major David sat in the bedroom and watched it, and I sat in the living room and watched my program. And he just kept on coming through. Another goal! Another goal! Keeping me updated. But we thank God for technology as well, isn't it? That we have been able to keep in touch with telephones, with iPads, computers, virtual meetings, all kinds of things. And we thank God for that. For me, it was in the garden. He prayed, not my will, but thine. He had no tears for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine. Let's listen once again as Major plays us the tune, and then we'll have two verses and chorus, yeah? And then somebody, one more person, to share with us as we're singing the last chorus. Make your way to the microphone and share with us. Don't be shy. Yeah? It's difficult, isn't it, when we haven't been having things for so long. But we're able to share together in this way. Say, silence is golden. Is there anybody who feels, even from the dam, you can come, if you come to this mic and I'll meet you.
As an advocate of somebody who said to the officer in numerous occasions that we need as much original material in these meetings as possible to make it worthwhile come to them, then I feel duty bound to testify. Now, whether that's a good enough reason, I don't know, but that is my reason. I'm also standing at this mic and not that mic because we're on camera, and I've noticed when I've watched the YouTube recordings that where I'm sat, there's always a big crest appears, and so I'm blocked out. And that leads me to the further point is when we now testify, we're under greater pressure, aren't we? Because we're on camera and anybody can access what we say. Could be that we say things that are compatible with our faith but may not be compatible with our work situation, and therefore some of us might find ourselves getting into bother that way. But who knows? That's for the Lord. But what I want to say is my personal testimony, and I'm glad that the Major just said what she did, that coming back together is proving difficult. Maybe she didn't use the word proving, but that's the word I'm using. During the lockdown, our papers, Salvation Army papers, were delivered by the commanding officer. Now, whether that means we're high up in the pecking order, I don't know, but he did tell me it fitted into his route when he was delivering his son to college. And in those conversations that we had at the doorstep, we talked about the future of the Corps and of our faith. And the Major said that most people he'd come across were fairly positive about the future. I simply said to him, well, I can quite easily redress that balance for you, Major, and come across in a negative way. And that's basically where my testimony is. I'm reading lots of material that talks about a new way forward. Even this morning, I opened an email, again from the CO, with two missives in from the Territorial Commander and the General, and recommending two books, which being arrogant, I don't think we really need to read because we probably know the direction that they want us to go into. But we're talking about the future. Unfortunately, my personal experience at the moment dictates that I'm in the past. I've got a song or a hymn that is going through my mind all the time. And it's one that used to be sung at school back in the 1960s. And at the end of a term, we would always sing the same song, hymn as we called it. We would have a hymn book and it would have in there the words, make more faithful those returning than before. And that is my testimony, quite simply, that as we re-engage with each other, that the Lord will make me more faithful than before.
Amen. so true, isn't it? And coming back into things can be very, and proves very difficult for a lot of people. And hopefully in the next couple of weeks, as things hopefully will unlock a bit more, we will be able to come, we'll be able to sing, and hopefully not to have to wear the masks. Maybe not all the way through, maybe coming in, I don't know. And then once you're sat, it would be nice, wouldn't it? So let's just pray for that, that God will indeed intervene in all these situations. Thank you for sharing with us this morning. Let's listen just now as the band bring to us their message. This I know, and I pray that you do know that for yourselves, for the Bible tells me so. Just now we're going to have the Bible reading taken from Isaiah, and Dave is going to come and bring that to us.
king as I died, saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. The whole theme were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they would fly. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." The sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" I said, "Here I am, send."
Amen. Thank you, David, for sharing that reading with us just now. Reading this morning from Isaiah. Isaiah had experienced a dramatic and life-changing moment. Not outside, but inside the temple. "I saw the Lord," he said, explaining his vision in such a way that readers still, I would say, I don't know how you felt when he said that. "I saw the Lord." And then the description. You feel that thrill. Of "I saw the Lord sitting on the throne." How would you feel if you saw the Lord sitting on the throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple? Isaiah went on to say that angelic beings surrounded the heavenly throne, their voices calling, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The very ground seemed to shake, and the room was filled with smoke. Overwhelmed by the power and greatness of it all, the young Isaiah impulsively cried out, "Woe is me! I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Intense self-awareness was his, as an awesome awareness of God overtook him. Isaiah's confession of unworthiness was countered by the swift action of one of the angelic beings touching his lips with a heated stone taken from the altar. He was addressed with these words, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." Divine cleansing and forgiveness transformed Isaiah's life in that instant, making him ready for the next and climactic part of his vision. He then, as we read on, heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" There was no hesitancy there, no holding back. Isaiah immediately replied, "Here am I, send me." And so the prophet was formed and fashioned to become a living and vital witness to the truth of God among the people of his time. It was this prophet who first anticipated the coming of the Messiah, the saving presence of one who would establish God's justice and righteousness upon the earth. Significantly, Isaiah helped sustain his people's faith and hope through perilous times. His nation was under constant threat from its enemies, and there were internal problems, you could say, of spiritual rebellion against God. Isaiah confronted these issues unflinchingly and beckoned his people to higher ground. Maybe we could hear somebody saying, we certainly could use an Isaiah among us today. A presence like his might indeed make a difference in public and private affairs, given the spiritual shortcomings of our present age. And who is to know? Maybe such a voice will be heard. Maybe such a person will appear. But lacking that, facing as we do days of decreasing commitment to traditional religious forms, are there responses that you and I can make? Does Isaiah's experience offer any pattern or guide for us to follow? Well, think again of what happened. Isaiah first allowed himself to be exposed to a worship setting. He went to the temple and attended to the practices of meditation and prayer. And in the midst of all that, this man felt the majesty of God and the magnitude of his own inadequacy. He felt himself a sinner, unclean, unworthy of such an encounter. But at the very utterance of that confession, forgiveness was granted to him. The wholeness of spirit. Isaiah, from that point forward, was ready, even eager, to go where God would send him, to speak what God would have him say. He became a movingly effective representative of hope and faith, using his talents to serve and to bless others for the rest of his days. Now, the linkages we can make with Isaiah's experience are very clear. From personal times of worship and prayer can come the renewing realization that we ourselves are forgiven by God. And when forgiven, we are free. We are free to be fulfilled in service to God. The sins and inadequacies and failures that dog our footsteps are removed. Divine love bestows a healing touch, causing our guilt to depart and our wrongs to be, as they say, blotted out, a clean slate. Thus cleansed inwardly, we are fortified to share outwardly the goodness and mercy of God. When individuals like all of us here allow ourselves to confront the holiness of God, when finally we admit that we have stained lips and inhabit a sinful world, when we humbly accept the restoring forgiveness that God extends, then, like Isaiah, the good news of God's love flows from our lives, and faith grows strong. We become not peddlers of God's message, but people truly sent from God, passing along the blessings. Passing along the blessings we have received and we know. This is what we are here for. This is the calling every one of us receives, to pass our faith along. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 to 17, it says this: "But thanks be to God who made us captives and leads us along in Christ's triumphal procession. Now, wherever we go, he uses us to tell others about the Lord and to spread the good news like a sweet perfume." There's a lovely illustration I love to use, and some of you may remember it, and I'll know by the smile, some of you may not. And it's about that telly advert there used to be on years ago of Impulse. Do you remember it? The Impulse advert for perfume. You may remember it, you may not. I remember it very clearly. But if you've seen one, you've seen them all, really. And the format really didn't change for years. And the woman there sprays herself, okay? She sprays herself with this Impulse. And as she is walking around, a man catches a whiff of the perfume. And it's just as if he can't help himself. And he rushes to the nearest florist. On these commercials, there's a florist just around the corner, you know? So he rushes to get these flowers, and the woman disappears. But just when he thinks that he has lost her, he bumps into her again, and he gives her the flowers. They both look suitably embarrassed. The adverts end, and the next thing is about baked beans. What is the advert trying to say? Well, its sole aim is to make you buy the perfume. And I think that they try to do this by saying that if you wear this perfume, then you will make an impact on those you meet, as they will be attracted to you because you smell so good. If you wear this perfume, then you will stand out in the crowd as someone special. Well, as Christians, we should be different. In a crowd, we should stand out as something special, not necessarily because of anything we have said or we wear, but because of our lifestyle. Our lifestyle is different from those around us, and because we are special, the people that we meet should be attracted to what they see. This is what the unusual analogy of the Apostle Paul means when he said, "We are the aroma of Christ to God among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. Through us," wrote Paul, "spreads in every place the fragrance that comes from knowing God." Paul went on to say, "In Christ, we speak as persons of sincerity, as persons sent from God, and standing in his presence." Just as a man in the ad is attracted to the woman who is wearing this perfume, so people should be attracted to us. Through our lives, the way we live, the way we act, we spread the fragrance of Jesus. What is the purpose? Well, the purpose is simple: to help people find salvation through Christ Jesus. I was interested to note that in the reading it says that we are the aroma of Christ among those who are being saved. there's something quite positive about the way in which that verse is worded. There seems to be that assurance that if we allow the aroma of God to permeate through our lives, then people will be saved. It says, those who are being saved, it is not a possibility, but a promise. That sort of testimony goes a long way toward encouraging others to consider Christian faith for themselves. Author and minister James Reed wisely noted that God is not revealed by argument, but by a quality of spirit which creates the capacity to feel and respond as light awakens the eye to see. Nothing else will reach the heart. Lives which lack serenity or grace have no attractive power. So it is that we who would pass faith along become the sweet savor of Christ, the aroma of Christ that draws others to Him. Our forgiven and surrendered lives may well impart the quality of perfume that permeates the air, you could say, as the Apostle Paul described. Or they may have about them what can be called a radiance or a brightness. By whatever description, changed lives involve us in ministries to change the world. Not just here in our own little place, but in our community. In the whole of Sunderland, in the whole of the UK, in the whole of the world, we need to take seriously our responsibility for passing Christian faith along to others. Now, you may be thinking, I'm not an evangelist. You can't bring anyone to Christ. But if we were to conduct a survey of the churches here in Sunderland and around the UK and the world, we would most likely find that the majority of those who attend church do so because they were invited by a friend, a family member, not because they attended an evangelical campaign. So the challenge for us then is to consider if we can pass our faith, invite our friends, our family to church. It may take a while, but eventually we pray God will speak into their hearts. The greatest act of love and friendship will surely be to share Christ with them. So I'd like to place a challenge with you today. Perhaps once you leave here this morning, you could contemplate on how best you can share the fragrance of Christ to those that you meet. And if you feel that you are not allowing God to move in your life, you are putting up barriers, maybe, maybe like Isaiah, you need to confess your unworthiness, your sins, and ask God to send a new touch of power on my soul, that your lips may be touched with a coal from the altar, just like Isaiah, to be renewed once again. Or maybe you just want to pray for strength for yourself or for someone else. For whatever reason, normally I would say this place of prayer is open for you to come and to kneel and pray. But due to the restrictions, can pray for you especially. And for those that are at home, wherever you are, that God may indeed touch your lips with a call from his altar. Send a new touch of power. And just now, in an attitude of prayer, Major Morris will play the tune for us, and the words will come up on the screen. Send a new touch of power on my soul, so that when God asks, and he will, whom shall I send, and who will go for us, there will be no hesitancy, no holding back, and immediately that reply will come, as I sigh, here am I, send me, help me to be that fragrance, so that others may come into a knowledge of Christ. So let's just listen as the tune is played, and then let us join together prayerfully, asking God to indeed send us that new touch of help. Lord, we just ask once again that you may indeed send a new touch of power upon each one of us represented here this morning, to those who will be watching, those seeking, knocking at the door. We ask that you will indeed be with each one of them just now, that you will infill us and you will use us to impart that fragrance to others so that they may come into a knowledge of you, Lord. We pray for those who have not been able to be with us here this morning. You know there are reasons why. And we pray that you will just be with each one of them, wherever they may be, that you may indeed guard and protect them and infill them with your spirit. For us, Lord, as we have come here in your presence, we just thank you for that opportunity. And we pray that in the days that lie ahead, as restrictions are lifted, that you will help us and keep us safe, protect and guard us, that you will just show your almighty power, and that you will help us as we come back together again in a different way again. So Lord, continue to be with us as we go from this place. Help us to be that aroma, that fragrance that will make others want to know what is so different, and to ask the question, I want what you have. So Lord, continue to be with us. Strengthen us and guide us in the way that we should go. All these things we ask in and through Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In closing this morning, I chose the song 992, my eyes, see, I'm vain and I don't like wearing my glasses all the time. Number 992. What better words to say, sing, or to listen to the words, and we'll look at the words on the screen. Who is on the Lord's side? Who will serve the King? Who will be his helpers, other lives to bring? Who will leave the world's side? Who will face the foe? Who is on the Lord's side? Who for him will go? By thy grand redemption, by thy grace divine, we are on the Lord's side. Savior, we are thine. And make that your testimony this morning as we leave this place. Now the God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another according to Christ Jesus, that ye may with one mind and one mouth glorify God. Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now the God of peace be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen. May God bless you.
Thank you.